rebels. And if you're going to do it personally.
And you don't want to do that. You're not an organizer. You're an organizer.
Everybody is a real problem. I want to just do what they're called. You have to eat. They're called. You need something part of the social. Anyway, he got about a dozen landscapes. And what he got is he had the sky, and the sky foreground. But you've got the sky and the foreground, and you painted them, and it's all the same.
Yeah.
And then he said, yeah, some days I feel like painting trees, so I'll probably put trees on.
Or which day could you like?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, I paint half a dozen block lakes more of them.
I am overawed, impressed. I mean, there's so many things that you seem to be able to do with this. Wow. I mean, I like very much the where you've got the metal and the felt together. Oh yeah, the multiple media together. That's wonderful. So I'm going to shut up, and I'm going to ask you to tell us who you are. And what you do, and anything that you think you want to tell people, and all that nifty stuff like that, okay?
Okay. Well, my name is Alison McCreesh.
Hi.
I work with many, many things, but mostly here today with wool. And what I am doing right now is that I have prepared a bunch of really thin, really delicate sort of blended colors, all these separate little pieces, which I'm looking now into putting together to make some sort of a Northern Lights abstract design. Because all of them, they have parts that you can see through, they have parts where you can see the actual curliness of the wool, and they have parts that are thicker. So I just want to sort of work with them the way you'd work with paint. Giving it depth and contrast, and a bit of light and a bit less light. So I'm trying to figure that out right now. So that is one way that you can approach wool and felt and fibers, sort of the way you would paint the color. But there are also many other ways that you can work with the wool, either through wet felting, which is what I was doing today, which you generally use to either make little balls, little round hard woolen beads, where you sort of shock the wool with hot soapy water, cold water, and then rub them together, and with the friction and the thermic shock, they become hard. The fibers just sort of become one. So that's one way you can do it. Or the other way you can do it is with a needle, a special felting needle, and then you poke. So for example, in poking, you can draw something like this. Lay wool out and poke. Or when you're poking, you can make something like this. That's more like a little sculpture, like these. Or even these, for example, are sculptures made out of wool. Wow. Just from poking. There's no structure. It's just the knotting, sort of dreadlocking of the wool together. So those are sort of the two main ways you can work, and I try and, yeah.
Is this, when I hear felting, I now know more from what you just told me than I knew before. But I think of felt hats when I think of that. Is there some kind of connection with what we used to, back in the, 20s, the 2 centuries ago, that kind of felt hat?
Yeah, it's basically the same thing. I mean, same thing. The felt hats were good because they were hot and they were waterproof and windproof, and, you know, it was just from the fibers coming together really tight. Of course, they had another process to do that. that you would use on solid things, mercury. And when you use mercury, you know, you kind of lose it eventually.
Yeah, which is mad as a hatter.
So that's, but now I'm not doing it with mercury, and I'm not. I mean, lots of people make hats sort of in a craft way now, out of felt.
Okay.
But to make an actual sort of 20s felt hat, you need a mold, and you need a, it's a slightly different technique.
How long have you been working this muse?
A couple of years. When I first started, I was living in the Yukon in Dawson City, and it was very exciting to me because until then I'd been working with styrofoam and oil paints and fiberglass and, you know, very contemporary media, which I enjoyed a lot and have a lot of possibilities. But when I discovered wool and, you know, that I could basically do anything, I could sculpt, I could draw, I could paint, I could do sort of almost everything I was doing before, I could weave, you know, do a lot of very contemporary things too, beyond the crafty side, but with this medium, this organic, natural, biodegradable that I could travel with because it's light, that I can have in my tent, that I won't poison me, that I don't need a special studio space. And yeah, it made a lot more sense with, you know, the way I live and think and act. And so ever since then I've been, you know, I did more contemporary gallery work with felt, and what you see today is more of my traveling, selling, more, yeah, accessible work with wool.
That's great, thanks. Where can people get in touch with you if they want to see more of your work or see some or buy some of that lovely jewelry that I just saw?
People could email me, I suppose, and for the people who are in Yellowknife, we will be selling at a few different venues during the summer, amongst other things, at Folk on the Rocks. And on Sunday, June 18th, at the Northern Museum Place, there's an event where we'll also be selling some crafts.
Okay, and your email address is?
My email address is... which one is worth figuring out?
Been there.
Well, I'll just have to go back to the old Hotmail, which isn't as professional, but here you go. It's Nosila, N-O-S-I-L-A, so Alison, back to front, _M as in a mummy, @hotmail.com. So that's Nosila, _M @hotmail.com.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thanks a lot, George.
Thank you. Nice stuff. I like it.